Hello and welcome to the fourth episode in the CPT Explained series. So, in this episode we're going to be looking at the DIP functions of CPT. As I said in the first episode, which looked specifically at each cognitive function, it's very helpful to imagine a kind of space that exists in between two opposites of the same orientation. For example, extroverted sensing and extroverted intuition, introverted thinking and introverted feeling. When you begin to imagine that space, you begin to picture in your mind how that space can be essentially traveled within the psyche. This is referred to as a cognitive continuum within CPT. And the major benefit from this is that it allows us more accuracy when describing the way in which a cognitive function is being expressed. And it allows for a system that actually accommodates fluid interaction between one function and another. Essentially, it allows us to actually specify what's going on rather than just alluding to it. So a dip is really nothing more than, as the word implies, a dip into the other end of a cognitive continuum. For example, if I'm gazing at something within this room, I render it through that gaze tangible. As soon as I lock onto something, it becomes, at least to a degree, perceived through extroverted sensing. However, if I were to suddenly broaden my gaze out in order to encapsulate a greater space within this room, that which I was perceiving beforehand loses its tangible quality because I'm essentially zooming out into extroverted intuition. And this would be referred to as an extroverted sensing, extroverted intuitive dip within CPT. I'm locking on to a specific tangible value, an external reality, and then rendering my perception abstract in order to encapsulate a greater array of values within that same space. And as explained in episode 1 in this series, that really is the raw essence of each of these functions. Everything else that springs up as a result in observable reality is merely symptomatic of that cause. For example, extroverted sensing, focusing in on a specific thing, renders that thing much more tangible and concrete. And then automatically, it creates a kind of present tense orientation because you're no longer comparing that object to everything else, and therefore time ceases to exist in the same way as it would be within an extroverted intuitive, extroverted thinking, for example, contingency. And that is why, of course, extroverted sensing exists on an axis with introverted intuition, because absent introverted intuition, there is no internalized conjecture and thus no anticipation of what is going to come. But of course, humans are humans, and partially attributed, if not entirely attributed, to the existence of DIP functions, nobody is truly past-oriented. Nobody is truly present-oriented. Nobody is truly living within a chain of external causality, and nobody is truly living in the future. Everybody's recall tends to suck. Everybody struggles to get into the flow. Everybody struggles to adapt to an ever-changing world around them. And everybody struggles to form accurate projections as to what the future entails. And ultimately, we are much more united by what makes us human than we are divided by type. And it is very important to mention that most cognitive dipping goes on entirely automatically. There's nothing you can do about it. If you're using introverted thinking in the background, such as an ETP engaged in a social setting, you're still going to be using introverted feeling. If an introverted intuitive such as myself has locked within their own thoughts, they're still going to be absorbing information from external reality, and it's still going to be cross-referencing the concrete against the abstract. Psychology 101, just because you're not aware of it, it doesn't mean it's not going on. Although I guess that applies universally as an existential principle. And to get a general visual impression of the sheer amount of automated dipping that goes on within a psyche, just imagine a straight line, and then draw a wiggly line going, you know, up and down. Well, this space above the line represents introverted intuition in an introverted intuitive dominant. But even though the majority of the energy is still above introverted intuition, there's still plenty of energy underneath the line within extroverted intuition. However, while plenty of the cognitive dipping that occurs within our psyche is automated, there is still plenty of dipping that occurs of our own free will, of our own volition. So as I've already alluded to, continuums exist not just between two opposing cognitive functions like extroverted sensing and extroverted intuition, but also between two opposing orientations such as extroverted sensing and introverted sensing. And from my observations so far, whether or not a function is easy or difficult to dip into is much more dependent upon its respective access point than it is on whether or not it's an orientation dip or a function dip. Introverted feeling within an ENTP, volitional dipping here, is going to be a lot harder, because you have two functions directly opposing it. It's not as easier as dipping into introverted feeling from extroverted feeling, because you have introverted thinking as the authority function of this type. And of course, introverted feeling is a natural opposite of both introverted thinking and extroverted feeling, and therefore you have a kind of double whammy. So there are essentially two dips that can take place from the position of any respective function. The first of one is simply a reversal of orientation. The function's not being changed, merely its direction. Whereas the other one is the actual function dip that takes place, because the nature of the function, for example, extroverted sensing into extroverted intuition, is being fundamentally changed. So now that we've defined what a dip function is, it is now time to apply the concept to each respective cognitive continuum, starting with extroverted sensing. So first of all, let us take the orientation dip. Here, extroverted sensing is corresponding the concrete external perception to the concrete internal perception. That means essentially relating external concrete value to internally stored concrete value. This process is absolutely fundamental to assert whether or not an object you are gazing at is familiar, for example. And the other dip that could be occurring from this position would be an extroverted intuitive dip. So extroverted sensing is gazing at a specific object, rendering it concrete and tangible owing to the intensity of the gaze, and then expanding one's perception outwards in order to cross-reference that value against multiple other ones. And now let us take extroverted intuition, first of all, starting with the orientation dip. Here, extroverted intuition is comparing and contrasting the abstract perception of the external world to the abstract perception of the internal world. For example, I am perceiving movement within the external atmosphere, and I'm now going to internally visualize that same movement and cross-reference it against stored information within my mind. And the function dip here is the exact inverse of the extroverted sensing one, because extroverted intuition here is starting from a very zoomed out perspective, gazing at multiple things at once, and then zooming in to a specific object of interest. And as soon as this zoom occurs, what is being perceived is rendered much more intense and tangible as a result. And now let us start with the orientation dip of introverted sensing. If an introverted sensor wants to correspond the internal concrete perception to the external concrete perception, they need to take their gaze and direct it externally. For example, can I reproduce what I'm internally perceiving in the external concrete atmosphere? Whereas the function dip here, introverted sensing into introverted intuition, a major reason why, by the way, introverted sensors can mistype as introverted intuitive dominance, would be essentially taking what was originally a very precise internal perspective, a very raw and intense experience of an internal value, and suddenly extrapolating it across consciousness. The difference here between an SI dominant and an NI dominant being the SI dominant starts from and primarily resides within a more concrete and intensely precise internal perception. And now let us take introverted intuition. If it is a orientation dip, the introverted intuitive, such as myself, would be trying to correspond an internal abstract perception against an external abstract perception, or an internal exploratory process to an external exploratory process. For example, as a musician, I recently had a cool new idea for a guitar technique, but I didn't actually begin to realize that idea fully, actually explore it and its implications, until I applied it to an external medium, the guitar. Here I was essentially dipping into extroverted intuition from introverted intuition. However, the function dip here would be instead introverted intuition into introverted sensing. This is when the broad holistic perception of internal reality really hones in to a specific value. And oftentimes, if you hear someone talking about the laser focus of introverted intuition, they are actually referring to an introverted sensing dip from an introverted intuitive standpoint, because you are suddenly honing in to a specific desire and then oftentimes locking that desire in place. So those were essentially the lens functions of CPT. A lens can either broaden its scope or narrow its scope, respectively. But it can also reverse its orientation. And so when you're trying to picture a kind of an orientation continuum, it's helpful to picture a line going down the middle, and then try and see perhaps a field of view about that wide. Well, as you can see, you've got that line here. The field of view can either be directed entirely externally, or it can begin to encapsulate some of both internal and external, or it can go completely and utterly internally. As you may have realized, you know, from your own existence, it's actually impossible to be completely extroverted and completely introverted. Even when you were dreaming, which is of course an appropriate counter-argument to what I'm saying, your mind is still subconsciously aware of what's going on in the space around you. And even in the most bliss-like state of meditation, where you are in a pure state of extroversion, completely absent internal thought, there's still subconscious thought going on in the background. So with those lens functions out of the way, that is the perceiving functions, let us now get to the codec functions. And let us now start with extroverted feeling. If you are experiencing a social situation, if you are monitoring and harmonizing with the external subjective world, you're still going to be cross-referencing that experience against your own self-concept. And this is why both extroverted feeling and introverted feeling are on the limbic continuum. Not because they're basic, but because they're concerned with the self. It is simply the difference between the self being out there and the self being in here. And this one's very much parallel to the continuum of individualism and collectivism. Because we're essentially doing the same thing, that is, relation of the self to the other. They're just approaching it from a different standpoint. So the extroverted field will therefore be dipping into introverted feeling in order to cross-reference the subjective other against the subjective self. And this dialogue is absolutely paramount to, first of all, ensure the extroverted feeler does not lose their individual sense of identity amidst the collective, but also to allow for the collective to inform their identity as well. However, the cognitive dip here is completely different. Here, extroverted feeling is dipping into extroverted thinking. Why is that? Because they're both inhabiting either sides of a rationalistic external continuum. For example, if an ESFJ wanted to accomplish a goal, lead a project, they're going to be dipping into extroverted thinking a heck of a lot in order to ensure that project is realized. It's stemming from an extroverted feeling perspective and therefore may often have a very humanitarian agenda, but the employment of extroverted thinking is not to be disputed. Conversely, let us now take extroverted thinking, starting with the orientation dip. Well, you probably notice it's rather impossible to understand anything you are gazing at without some level of introverted thinking dialogue. You can, of course, perceive the external relationships, but you need to be able to store those relationships in internal frameworks to be able to use them outside of working memory. Extroverted thinking dominance, ENTJs, for example, are well-renowned oftentimes for an incredible use of introverted thinking, particularly when that introverted thinking is used as a natural extension of an extroverted thinking dialogue. What extroverted thinking values am I perceiving, and what do I know to be true? What rationalistic principles can I employ in order to maximize my output? But you may have noticed, especially in this modern world we live in order to really maximize that output, achieve your goals optimally, even understand the world around you, you need to be able to work with and correspond with, communicate with others. And this is where the function dip comes in, because for an ENTJ, for example, to affect their world in an optimal fashion, they need to be able to network. They need to be able to ride the waves of extroverted feeling atmospheres. It's exceptionally difficult to do this without using extroverted feeling. It's possible, but a lot of brain power has to be dedicated to use introverted thinking and extroverted thinking to make up for a complete absence of extroverted feeling. The path of least resistance here is simply to dip into extroverted feeling in order to more intuitively understand the social world around you. And now let us visit the inverse orientation of the codec function, starting with introverted feeling. Well, absent an extroverted feeling dip, the introverted feeler can actually feel completely isolated from not only humanity, but experience and life as a whole. It is oftentimes necessary for the introverted feeler to be able to invert this codec sufficiently so as to align the self-concept with the concept of others. We are not islands unto ourselves. Our identity is informed by others, just as the identity of others is informed by us. Whereas introverted feeling alone has the ability to see others as an extension of self, it is extroverted feeling that has the ability to see self as an extension of others. So essentially, introverted feeling dips into extroverted feeling, not only to express the self, not only to cement the self in external reality, but also to make the self more real, to essentially unite this individualistic and collectivistic continuum. Because true self-actualization entails a unification of both of these opposites. The self must become other, and the other must become self. So introverted feeling here is essentially dipping into extroverted feeling in order to reconcile the self with the other. However, in order to actualize the self and understand the self, introverted feeling must also dip into introverted thinking. A degree of introverted thinking dip is absolutely paramount to an introverted feeling experience. Introverted thinking rationalizes upon the self. It gives meaning to sensation. It gives meaning to impulses and desires and identity. I would even say practically half of a person's identity is comprised of introverted thinking frameworks. But self-concept and identity, this isn't the only thing to be resting within the very center of this respective introverted feeling, introverted thinking continuum. No, we also have moral values, heuristics, logical principles we attach emotional significance to. And in this sense, a feeling thinking continuum is practically self-evident. And now let us visit introverted thinking. Well, first and foremost, in order to be able to create a framework, to actually feel secure in its validity, you need to be able to cross-reference it against reality. This is where the introverted thinking, extroverted thinking dip comes into play. It is this extroverted thinking dip that allows for an introverted thinking dialogue to be empirical. It is not only employing rationalistic principles, but it is also cross-referencing those principles against observable reality. Does this line up? Does this fit? And this is something I have to do constantly with CPT. Whenever I'm expanding the theory, whenever I'm about to get in front of the camera and put forward a new idea, a new theoretical principle, I need to be able to cross-reference that idea against the data beforehand. And it is only when this hypothesis I am testing is found to line up with reality that I'm actually comfortable getting in front of the camera and communicating it to you, in front of potentially, you know, thousands of people. I want to make sure what I'm saying is backed up by the data. So yes, for an introverted thinking framework to be constructed, it has to be cross-referenced against objective reality. Just as for objective reality to be changed and fully understood, there must be a level of introverted thinking dialogue going on. And finally, let us get to the function dip of introverted thinking. This would be introverted feeling. Introverted thinking is always going to be informed by introverted feeling, and vice versa. There's no way around that. It's just part of the human condition. Your ideas are always going to have some level of cognitive bias. They're always going to be, to some degree at least, rationalizing your own emotions. Just because you're not necessarily conscious of those emotions, it does not mean they are not driving you forward in your own rational conjecture. And most of the time, let us be honest, we are pretty blind to our own cognitive biases. But introverted feeling isn't just this negative force preventing introverted thinking from being truly objective. No, it informs introverted thinking. It allows introverted thinking frameworks, for example, to be reconciled with the self. It allows the self to believe things. It also allows for the self to be understood. If introverted thinking is dipping into introverted feeling, it is rationalizing upon the self. Why am I feeling this way? Why is this meaningful to me? Should this be meaningful to me? It is actually this dip that allows introverted thinking to eliminate cognitive biases. If introverted thinking was absent in introverted feeling dip, there would be no control over our biases. It is actually this dip that allows for introverted thinking to be objective in the first place. And that concludes episode 4 in the CPT Explained series. So in the next episode, we're going to be taking this very same dipping process, but doing so through a lens codec perspective. That is to say, observing how a dip can be changed according to, for example, a different lens assigned to introverted thinking, or a different codec assigned to introverted sensing. It is in episode 5 that we will begin to put these pieces together to show how an ISFJ can be more INTJ-like, for example, to show how an ENTP can be more ESFJ-like. And for your own self-study, I'd highly recommend comparing this episode to episode 3, essentially applying the principle of dipping to a codec lens perspective, looking at cognitive functions in pairs, and seeing how these pairs would dip into their natural opposites. But that does bring us to the end of the video, so first and foremost, thank you for watching, especially if you made it this far, you are awesome. If you haven't already done so, I highly recommend subscribing to the channel, and if you did enjoy the video or just generally found it informative, be sure to let me know by hitting that like button below. And just a few more call to actions before I go. If you're interested in the very fundamentals of CPT, I highly recommend checking out the CPT ebook. And if you yourself are interested in what type you might be, or just would like to know about how your type applies to you as an individual, I highly recommend checking out my type services and consultations. CPT is also on Patreon, so if you are interested in supporting the channel on that additional level, that would be massively appreciated. But of course, it goes without saying, I really appreciate your support over here as well. And on a Patreon note, I'm actually going to start trying out monthly live streams over there. So if you are interested in connecting with me over there or just sharing ideas, talking CPT once a month, it would be absolutely great to see you there. So that's it from me, and I'll be seeing you next week. For now, take care.